morning, church. We're so glad that you're here today. Why don't you stand together and we'll worship.
Out of the wilderness, into deliverance, look where I'm standing now. These hands that once were chained, now lifted high in praise, look where I'm standing now. Look where I'm standing now. I stand on the chain breaking, miracle making, powerful name of Jesus. On the body raising, prodigal saving, powerful name. Your mighty hand into the promised land. Look where I'm standing now. Carrying the cross for me. Now I am a child of the King. Look where I'm standing now. Look where I'm standing. Stand on chain breaking, miracle making, powerful name of Jesus. On the body raising, prodigal saving, powerful name of Jesus. Hallelujah, I'm free. Hallelujah. Jesus, my Savior, rescue. Hallelujah, I'm free. Hallelujah, I'm free. Jesus, my Savior, rescue.
Joining us online, glad that you could be a part of worship with us today. If you don't know, my name's Joe. I'm the pastor here at LifeSong. If you happen to be new and you're in the house today, and by the end of the service, you have some questions or would just like to meet me and tell me all the things that you love or don't love about me, I want to invite you just to hang out. My wife and I, she exists, I promise. We'll meet you at the information center right out there in the lobby. If there's a large enough group of you, we'll go back to our starting point room where we can have some better discussions. Or you can just stop by and say hi, introduce yourself. We'd love to meet you. A couple of things we do want to make you aware of before we get back into worship today. Number one, I want to remind you that this coming Wednesday night, We're going to move our Wednesday nights back to 6:30. That's our fall and winter schedule, kind of lining up with the school year. But this Wednesday night, we are going to set aside some time and dedicate specifically to praying for our students, teachers, school faculty, and homeschool families that are headed back into school. This Wednesday is the first full day of public school here in Marshall County. And we know, there's like excitement and students in the room that are crying bitterly. There's a lot of emotions about going back to school, especially this year, because last year was very different and looked very strange. And because it was strange, this year by nature is strange. And so we want to encourage you to be in prayer for all of those students and faculty and teachers now, but even more so, we want to come together and be intentional about that on Wednesday night, because kids are coming home with lots of emotions, good and bad. Teachers and faculty are coming home with lots of emotions, good and bad. And we just want to support them in prayer. One of the reasons we feel so strongly about that is we were talking this morning in our pre-service leadership meeting. Here at LifeSong, we have some kind of a presence in all but one of our public schools here in Lewisburg. That's elementary all the way up through high school. And so that's people who are on staff, people who are faculty. We have direct contact with some of those schools and providing some resources in the way of supplemental food and those kinds of things for students. And actually two of those schools host Bible clubs that we get to be a part of when the world is properly turning on its axis. And so we are so blessed and in such a unique position to have a presence and an influence in our public schools. And so we want to encourage you to be a part of Wednesday night as we lift all of those people and all of those things up in prayer. That's 6:30 Wednesday night right here in the worship center. Also want to encourage you, definitely follow us on all of our social media platforms. Check out our website, because that's where you're going to find out about all of the new things that are coming up as we get back into our fall schedule. August 18th, so that's not this Wednesday or the next, but the following. August 18th is when we're going to kick back into that regular school year schedule. We've got Awana for students basically 3 years old on up through sixth grade. We've got Epic Student Ministries with that guy there. Sorry. So we've got something for everybody on Wednesday nights when we kick back in there on the 18th. We'd love for you to come out and be a part of that as well. Online family, make sure that you're watching for what Wednesday nights will look like for you coming up here in the next few weeks. So church, I'm just excited to be here and be able to worship with you today. There's something about being in the same space, in the same place with God's people. Whether you're a regular part of our church family or you're just a part of the body of Christ, there's something special when we come together, when we lift our voices in praise, when we lift our hands, when we just cry out to our God. Because he said he inhabits the praises of his people. So if this is something new and it's different to you, I want to encourage you today just to, if you don't know the words and you can't follow along, just let the reality that God is present in this room settle over you today. Because if we'll just give him just a little bit of our attention, he will take every opportunity available to him to make his power and his presence known. That's what he is going to do here today. And what we are going to do is invite him in, acknowledge that, and let him have his way and take us where he needs to go with us today. So would you stand to your feet with me as we get back into worship this morning? But before we do, would you pray with me as we welcome him in? And so God, we thank you that you're here in this space, in this place today. We thank you that you have called each one of us for a reason to be here in fellowship with one another today. And Father, we thank you for those who are not able to join us in person, but who are worshiping with us online. God, we thank you that you're not contained by these four walls, but that you are present in those homes and offices and workplaces, just like you are present in this room today. And so collectively, as your church, we're going to lift up a shout of praise, a song of thanks and adoration, giving glory and honor to you, God. And as we do so, we invite you to make yourself known, to show us your presence and your power in this place today. Jesus, we love you and we thank you for all that you have done for us. That's reason enough to sing today. If you never did one thing more, we already have a great well to draw from of your faithfulness, your grace, and your mercy. And so we lift all this up to you today in thanks and praise for all that you have done and all that you are. We praise you, we thank you, we love you, and give you all the glory today, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you join us in worship?
Sing it out, oh hero.
Oh hero of heaven, The reign of darkness now has ended. In the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of light, forever under your dominion. You're the king of my life. You're the king of my life. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe, and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. Now on the cross, the work was finished. God, you poured out your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, hear an anthem arise, 'cause Jesus, you're alive. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign. Darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running.
Have the communion elements. While we're playing this next song, will you guys make your way to either side of the stage and grab some communion elements?
Storm. Jesus.
Church, you can be seated for just a moment this morning. First Sunday of every month, we like to set aside some time where we turn our attention to communion. And you might call it something else depending on where you've come from, but ultimately we're talking about remembering the sacrifice that was made for each one of us on the cross. Talking about the work that was done there to purchase our salvation. And that Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, fully endowed with all the power of God, could have in an instant taken himself down off of that cross, shown his power, and proven that he was who he said he was, and that the very same power that fueled creation resided in him. He could have done that. There's a song that historically the church has sung that he could have called 10,000 angels. But he made a choice. He made a choice to stay where he was. He made a choice to see it through. He made a choice to be obedient to the Father, even unto death. Because in that death, he was purchasing life for us. In that death, he was laying himself down as the sacrificial lamb that had been prophesied for generations and generations and generations. He was setting aside his own physical well-being so that he might care for our spiritual well-being. He was setting aside the temporary earthly life so that he might provide for us an eternal life in the kingdom of God. And we're invited to partake of that life and to remember that sacrifice today. And in that, not only is there life and life more abundantly, life to the full, but we find peace. We find joy. We find hope. We find everything that we can go outside and seek in all kinds of ways in the world, but never truly find. We might find cheap substitutes. We might find things that are labeled one of those things, but they fall far short of what is available to us and offered to us through the blood and body of Jesus. And so just in these couple of moments, I just want to invite you to be in an attitude of prayer. And as we remember him and all that he has done, I want to make it clear that anyone who has taken that step across the line and trusts in Jesus as Savior, we invite you to this table. We invite you to be a part of this remembrance. And as you enter into that today, I want to invite you just to take a moment and let the Spirit of God bring to your heart and to your mind those things that maybe you've just stumbled a little bit in. You've been a little bit too distant from your Father, from God. You've allowed some things maybe to come between the two of you that never should have been there. The Bible says we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And we're all in, as followers of Jesus, the process of sanctification. But we don't believe we ever arrive at full perfection on this side of glory. So we know that there are things in each one of us. We know that there are things in each one of our lives that create some distance. So I want you to just take this opportunity, just in your heart and in your mind, just to call out to God, to acknowledge those things and those ways where you have fallen short, to confess those to him. And in the process of doing so, to turn from those things and to turn back to your Creator and your Savior. To ask for and receive that forgiveness for those places where we've fallen short. And in doing so and believing in your heart and confessing with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, today we remember, Jesus, all that you have done for us. We remember the price that you paid, your willingness to not only go to the cross, but to carry it to that hill on your own back. Today we remember that you did for us what we could never do for ourselves. Atoning for all sin, for all time. We thank you today that it did not come as a surprise to you, but you were intentional. Even when it caused pain in your heart to know what lay ahead of you, and you cried out to the Father, "If it be your will, please let this cup pass from me, but not my will. Yours be done." So today, Jesus, we thank you that as we take this bread in the way that you took it on that night you were betrayed, we break it. We remember that you said, "This is my body broken for you." As often as you partake of it, do so in remembrance of me. Take and eat. And on that same night, in the same way, he took the cup. He said, "This is a new covenant, a new promise made with my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." Take and drink. Jesus, we thank you today that not only can we remember the sacrifice and the price that you paid, but we can celebrate the truth that because of that, we live in freedom. We live in a new life. We are a new creation in you. And you are our peace in the midst of and over every circumstance of this life. So we praise you and thank you today for how you have saved us and made us new. In your name, amen.
Let faith rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me. Rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me. Let faith rise up.
you that your word tells us that if we come to you, your yoke is light, Lord, and you will take our burdens from us. Lord, I pray that you would just speak peace over this room right now, Lord. With school going back, Lord, I know there's so much chaos and so much moving parts and everything like that, Lord, and some people might feel a little overwhelmed right now. I pray that you would just speak peace. Lord, your word tells us that you are a peace that passes all understanding. Lord, I pray that you would make that real right now. Lord, I thank you that no matter how crazy this world gets, you are constant. You are a strong tower that your people can run to and find refuge. Lord, and I just want to thank you that you're here in this place with us right now. Lord, I pray that you would speak through Joe today, that you would use him as your messenger to tell us what you need us to hear. Lord, I pray right now that you would tear down walls, that you would soften hearts, that we would be receptive to the message that you have for us, Lord, and we would come before you with humble spirits, ready to learn what you have for us. Lord, I pray that you continue to move in this place and just work wonders like you've always done, Lord. Thank you for everything you're doing right now and everything that you plan to continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. I want to thank you for joining us today and for being a part of how God is moving here at LifeSong. Your continued giving helps us fulfill the mission God has set before us, and there are several ways that you can do that. To give online, visit lifesongfamily.org/give. You can also text any amount to 931-286-7788 to give through Text to Give. Giving is also available right inside our app. You can download the app for both Apple and Android devices from our website. You can also give through the giving box at the back of the worship center, or you can send your offering by mail to LifeSong Family Church, 1041 South Ellington Parkway, Lewisburg, Tennessee, 37091. No matter how you choose to give, your faithfulness allows us to continue to support our local pregnancy center and to serve our neighbors through Seeds of Hope Community Food Bank. When we all partner together with God in our giving, it helps us create those opportunities for all people to experience real love, real generosity, real faith, and real community, starting right here at LifeSong. So as I mentioned, we are kicking off a new series today, but before I get into the first message of that series, I want to pick up kind of where our giving video just left off, and I want to talk about a couple of different things. First of all, you hear me say pretty regularly, and you hear in that giving video, that when you give here at LifeSong, you not only give to what we do right here on campus, but you help to support some other ministries or arms of LifeSong ministries as well. One of those other ministries outside of the church that you help to support is the Pregnancy Resource Center, in his image, Pregnancy Resource Center here in Lewisburg. And they do fantastic work, have an amazing ministry to young parents, parents of young children, parents who are unexpectedly expecting, all those kinds of things. And they do stuff that we just simply cannot do inside the church. And so we come alongside them and we partner with them on an ongoing basis to support what they do there. But I want to share with you, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but a letter that came to us from Miss Shirley, who is a part of our church family and here today. Love you guys. But we just last month, well, nope, it's August now. So in June, we wrapped up being a part of their annual baby bottle campaign. And they had a pretty big need that was kind of looming on the horizon coming in to that baby bottle campaign. They needed a new roof. We know what that's like around here at LifeSong Family Church. And it's not a cheap thing to get done. And so each year, the PRC, Pregnancy Resource Center, does a baby bottle campaign. It's called that because they send out empty baby bottles, which we distribute through the church, and other churches do this as well. You fill those up with all kinds of, you know, cash, checks, stocks, bonds, titles to vehicles, whatever you can fit down in there. And then all of those donations go directly to them and help support the work that they do. And they were really targeted towards needing that new roof. And so this year through the Baby Bottle Campaign, the total amount that was collected through 39 different churches and individuals and a civic club was a little over $30,500. That's huge. Yeah. And then specifically, those of you who are a part of Life Song, and if your baby bottle went out and came back through here, we collectively contributed a little over $1,450 toward that $30,000 collective total. So that's huge giving above and beyond what we already do to help them meet their needs. Now, here's the cool thing. When you drive through downtown Lewisburg now, it won't be this way forever, praise God, because it only takes so long to do this. But right now, when you drive through downtown Lewisburg and you drive past the Pregnancy Resource Center, you can see the people doing the work on their new roof, and you can be excited that you got to be a part of that in some kind of way, because the new roof is going on right now. I've been watching as I drive by each day. So we're excited to see that. And if you've never been to the Pregnancy Resource Center to receive their services, I want to encourage you to go over there, meet Miss Shirley, schedule a tour to see what they do. And I promise you, there's a space and a place within the ministry of the PRC where you can get involved and you can be a part of ministering to families through them. But as we give here at Life Song, we're committed, and you hear this all the time. I'm going to talk about it more frequently because some things have changed. As we give, we are committed to an institutional or an organizational tithe. So that means everything that comes in, 10% of it goes right back out to other ministries or missional partners like the Pregnancy Resource Center or the Food Bank, which is another ministry of Life Song Ministries. We have just recently switched things up a little bit to also include a different missional partner each month. And so last month was the first month we did this, and our missional partner was Hopetown. And so here within the next week or so, we'll be sending some funds over to Hopetown to help support what they do there. But this is the first Sunday of August, so now we're moving on to our August missional partner. So when you give during the month of August, there's a portion of everything that comes in August that's going to go back out to the West Hills Elementary chapter of FCA. If you don't know what FCA is, FCA stands for Fellowship of Christian Athletes. That's one of those ministries in public schools that we are very blessed to be able to be a part of. They meet once a month on campus at West Hills Elementary, and Lisa, our children's pastor, and I are invited to come and be a part of that, and we frequently have the opportunity to be able to not only invest in the lives of these kids, but also to be able to share the truth of Scripture and the gospel with them right on public school grounds. Yes, it happens. Don't believe the lie that it doesn't. It's there. But they run on, like, no budget. There's really no outside funds that are supporting that ministry. And so funds that do support it come from partner churches and then oftentimes from the teachers and the faculty who step up to lead that club and that organization within the school. And so the entire month of August, they are our missional partner. So know that when you give, you are not only impacting children here on campus, but you're impacting children who will never come through the doors of Life Song Family Church, but are still being reached with the message of the gospel. So I'm excited that that's where we're at for August in our giving. And I'm excited that that's just one more way that we get to live out real generosity, which is one of the things that we focus on here. Speaking of things that we focus on, I think it's time that we're talking about back to school, Some people take off most of the summer, and so they're going back to work. I don't know any of those people, but I hear that they exist. And so there's a lot of back to's, back to school, back to work, back to normal, back to, back to, back to, back to, back to. And so we're setting aside some time over the next few weeks to go back to basics. We're going to talk about the things that make up our foundation. Those things that, while all sorts of other things might change around us, and even some things might change about us, these things will never change, because they are solidly rooted and founded in the truth of Scripture, and they make up the core of who we are. And so before we can get into any of the great details of all those things, we kind of have to talk about where all those things really come from and where they are rooted. They are, of course, rooted in the Word of God. They're rooted in the Bible. And so anytime you start a new job, or you get a new car, or you enter into any kind of new situation, it's pretty standard that you receive some kind of a training manual. Now, you might not think of the owner's manual of your car as a training manual, but when you get a brand new car and you don't know how certain features work, where do you go? Well, some of us go to the owner's manual, and then some of us go to YouTube, if we're being honest, right? But in any case, you are consulting a source to train yourself how to use those features that you don't yet understand or know. So training manuals are not uncommon in life. No matter who you are or where you come from, you've probably encountered one in some kind of form. Now here's the thing. Sometimes those training manuals are easy to understand. I have a friend who used to work in an industry where his job was to write standard operating procedures for fracking. That's a form of drilling and mining. And he explained to me how frustrating it was to write those SOPs. And the way that he described it was this: you have to write everything like you're writing it for an idiot. I said, "What do you mean?" And he went to painstaking effort to explain to me all the different steps that he had to write into SOPs, standard operating procedures, just about how to tie off a rope. You had to describe what kind of rope. You had to describe what kind of knot and how to tie that knot. You had to describe exactly what that rope needed to be tied to and how big and wide and heavy that thing needed to be in order to hold the rope that he had already just described. So you and I might say, "Well, just tie that off over there." But it would take him 5 pages to get you there. Sometimes things that should be easy to understand are not so easy to understand. And then some things just aren't easy to understand. Are you confused yet? Good. Here's the thing. As believers and followers of Jesus, the Bible is our training manual. It's our instruction book. And more than that, it is a love letter from our Creator. So it is all those things and more wrapped up in one. So what we believe according to our official statement of faith is this: we believe and teach the Bible to be the inspired and the only infallible, authoritative, inerrant word of God. And you can find that and the rest of our statement of faith on our website. You can download it, and it's great bedtime reading. But that's what we believe about the Bible. That's what we believe about the Word of God. So infallible means it cannot fail. It will never be wrong. Authoritative means that it is the standard. It is the benchmark. It is our compass. And it is the final word in all things. And see, already we see where what we believe doesn't line up with the culture, right? Because there's certainly a movement in society today that wants to question or argue about the authority of the Bible. Call it antiquated. Call it outdated. Old school. But it is none of those things. It remains what it has always been, and that is the Word of God. God does not change. And so even if he said it 1,000 years ago, it remains true today. It is authoritative. Inerrant means that it is free of error or contradiction. You will never find two things in the Bible that contradict each other. And so anytime we find ourselves facing something in Scripture that makes us think maybe it is fallible, maybe it's not authoritative, maybe it's not inerrant, maybe it's not divinely inspired, which means it came through man, but from God by divine inspiration, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Anytime we encounter things in Scripture that make us think that it's not the things that we've clearly already established we believe that it is not our job to figure out how to manipulate or contort Scripture to fit with our understanding. It becomes our job to rely on the Holy Spirit at work within us to transform our understanding so that we can be better aligned with the Word of God. You will never find any error, any failure, or any fault in the Word of God. Standing on these truths is absolutely essential for a follower of Christ. If we doubt or we question these things about the Bible, it undermines our faith. Now, let me be really clear on that. That doesn't mean that you can't ask questions. That doesn't mean that you can't ever be confused by something that you read in the pages of Scripture. It has happened very frequently to me, and I'm sure it's going to happen again. And if it's never happened to you, you're probably not reading it very frequently. There's some crazy stuff in there that it's hard to get your brain around. There's some crazy stuff in there that we'll never fully understand on this side of heaven. Don't believe me? Take a drive through Lewisburg and count how many different denominations are represented inside our city limits. Do you know why there's so many? It's because there's things that they read in the pages of Scripture that they don't always agree on. And they have made them foundational truths for their denomination or their fellowship. I'm not saying that's right or that's wrong. I'm saying that's the reality of the church in the world today. So to be very clear, we will not always understand everything that we read in Scripture. But as followers of Jesus, we are also lifelong students of the Bible. That means if you woke up today and you are still breathing, whether you are 9 years old, 99 years old, or 900 years old, there's still something you can learn from the Word of God. We are lifelong students. Always something new to learn. Always something new to discover. So let's talk about just the basics of the Bible for just 1 second. What is it? How's it made up? And I'm not going to go super in-depth because you'll get that, you know, glazed donut look on your face and, you know, well, I'll lose you. So the Bible, total of 66 books. 66 books, that's 39 Old Testament books and 27 New Testament books. Already, some folks online or here in the room might be a little bit confused. What is the difference between Old Testament and New Testament? Old Testament are those books of the Bible that, number one, come before the incarnation of Christ. Incarnation of Christ means when he came in the flesh. So, Old Testament, everything before the first Christmas. It's the easiest way that I can explain it. It's also those books of the Bible that we pretty much agree on with our Jewish friends. So you're going to find most synagogues and Jewish practitioners are going to agree on Old Testament scriptures with us, at least what's contained in them. Now, we'll look at the Old Testament and we'll see prophecy pointing ahead to Jesus. They'll look at the Old Testament and they'll see prophecy pointing ahead to a Messiah, a Savior, who has not come yet. So we don't agree on everything, but at least we agree on the books. The 27 New Testament books start with the Gospels and go all the way through to Revelation. Those are the books that contain the account of the incarnation and life of Christ, and then the work of his apostles and the New Testament church, all the way up into Revelation, when he gives us some insight into things that are yet to come. And so through John, we have a window into the future in the book of Revelation. So we know John wrote the end, and we know that scholars teach us that Moses was responsible for the writing of Genesis, and really the first five books of the Bible, which are called the Torah, if you want to get into the Hebrew roots of things. But those are the 66 books. They give us an overarching storyline of how things were when God started it all in motion at creation, and how things will be at the end of the fullness of time. And that's where we cross the line from this instruction manual into a love letter from our Creator to us. Because he reveals himself and his plan to redeem all of creation through those 66 books. Now I want to take you to Scripture. We've established what the Bible is. And at the end of the day, it is a very thick book full of many, 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 many scriptures and verses and chapters in those 66 books. So I want to take you to the very first, simplest, foundational thing that we need to understand about the Bible. That's 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. If you have a Bible with you today, I invite you to turn there. We're going to go about four different places today. If you don't have a Bible with you and you don't have an app on your phone or your mobile device, scriptures will be up on the screen for you to follow along with. We're here in 2 Timothy, though, chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. And this is what it says. All scripture is God-breathed. And so right there is that inspired, divine inspiration. It comes from God, put on paper through man, but it comes from God. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, we really like the first thing that scripture is good for or useful for, and the last thing mentioned here that scripture is useful for. We really like teaching. We really like to learn from the Word of God inside the church. We really like training in righteousness, hearing about how we can be more like God and more conformed to his image. We like those things. But these two things that we really like kind of make a things we hate sandwich. Because right in the middle, we find rebuking and correcting. Show of hands, who likes to be rebuked? Crickets, that's what I thought. We don't like to be rebuked. We don't like to be corrected. We don't like to be told that we're wrong. We don't like to admit that we've been wrong. But when we line ourselves up against the Word of God, against the Bible, against Scripture, we're going to find ways and places and instances in our lives where we are wrong. And Scripture itself, if we're allowing the Spirit of God to move and work in us, Scripture itself will rebuke us and correct us if we'll allow Him to bring us back into alignment. Unfortunately, it doesn't always work that way. Some of us are very stubborn people. I won't ask you to raise your hand on that one. Some of us have to go through more of a process in rebuking and correcting. Some of us then have to bring ourselves into submission of other authorities who are going to help us get back on track when we've gotten too far off. But Scripture is useful for all these things. And it's useful for all these things so that, verse 17, the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I am all for people who are brand new in their faith getting connected in a way where they can begin serving God and serving His church in some kind of ministry, some kind of way. But a person who accepts Christ today and has never read the Bible before in their life does not start teaching a Sunday school class next Sunday. You are not thoroughly equipped for that good work. Scripture applied to your life, taught, rebuking, correcting, training you, that equips you and prepares you for things like that. But in the process, there's a lot of different ways that you can engage and be a part of the work of God's kingdom. Not everybody's going to be a teacher. Some people will live out decades of Christian life and never be a teacher, even though they are a student of the Bible. You're gifted in different ways. The Word of God helps you to discover that and be equipped for whatever the work is that God has set before you. Sometimes that's exciting and fun, and sometimes it's painful because He's molding us and shaping us and correcting us. The Word of God does that. That's part of why He's given it to us. And we have a responsibility to receive that and to apply it to our lives. If you flip back one chapter to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, we find this. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. Now, this is the verse that our Wednesday night children's ministry is built on. Our Wednesday night children's ministry during the school year is called Awana, A-W-A-N-A. It is not short for, I wanna go home. That is not what it means. Awana actually stands for Approved Workmen Are Not Ashamed, A-W-A-N-A. And it references this verse. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, who correctly handles the word of truth. And so it's that last part that I want to come and rest on for just a second. Correctly handles the word of truth. It's entirely possible to know what the Bible says and completely mishandle it. Now, the origin of that, the genesis of that, comes from our enemy. And if we see that nowhere else, we see it in the garden where he comes along and he says to Eve, "Did God really say?" Well, he knew what God said. He was just taking what God said and casting some doubt, contorting it, twisting it, making her question if that's really what it said. We see that he shows up again with great knowledge of Scripture when Jesus is in the desert for 40 days. And he begins to quote parts and pieces of Scripture to Jesus. I would caution you, don't ever assume that you know the Bible better than Jesus. Satan found that out in the desert, and Jesus had a rebuke or a rebuttal for everything that he said. But we're living in an age when sometimes this can get foggy. Not because our enemy, the devil, is standing in front of us using Scripture to try to pull us away or to cast doubt. He's much, much more crafty than that. See, we're living in an age when he will use individuals who seem to be very well-meaning, who seem to be very knowledgeable about Scripture, who seem on the surface to correctly handle the word of truth. But in reality, they are using Scripture to support a position that is not biblical. They are using Scripture to call things that God clearly defines as sin, as not sinful. Now, I'm sure that there are people who will hear this and won't appreciate what I'm about to say. But we're living in an age, and I get on this soapbox occasionally, and I try not to live here, because I would much rather prefer that we be known for what we are for and not what we are against. But sometimes you have to draw a clear line. And there's something out there today that's labeled as progressive Christianity. Progressive Christianity takes the Word of God and either cherry-picks scriptures that make them feel good, or takes scriptures that say one thing and they twist them to make them say something else. Or they throw the Bible out altogether as an authoritative Word of God. That's not Christianity. That's not the body of Christ. That is not God's church. That is a counterfeit. That is a scheme and a tool of the enemy to attempt to draw people into what appears to be a form of righteousness, but in reality has absolutely nothing to do with the righteousness of God. Now, I want to caution you here, because it's very, very easy to stand on these two passages from Timothy and begin to point fingers and call out other churches, ministries, or denominations that we don't always agree with. And I need to be clear, because we've talked about this as well. One of the other great tools of the enemy is friendly fire. Because we might all unite and say, yeah, that progressive woo-hoo-hoo weirdness, yeah, that's clearly not. But you know, this church over here on the other side of town, I think they're just meh, 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 because they don't do, or they do, or they whatever. And I said do, yep, sorry. Folks, the Bible is not intended to create infighting and battling within the body of Christ. It is not intended to be a weapon that we use against one another. It is a weapon of warfare that we use against the enemy. That is the Word of God. And so we also believe here that in essentials, salvation-related issues, there must be unity. We have to agree on the basic foundational truths of Scripture when it comes to those things that lead us to a saving relationship with Christ and what that means and what that looks like. But outside of that, there are a lot of things that are not directly related to salvation that we can gracefully agree to disagree on. And maybe one day when we all get to glory, we'll find out who was right and who was wrong. And my sincere hope is that when we get there, we both go, well, we were both wrong. And then we both just feel silly and move on. But we need to correctly handle the Word of God, correctly handle the Word of truth. And how do you do that? It is not simply by sitting and listening to me read it to you once a week on a Sunday morning. It's not simply listening to that on a Sunday morning and also showing up and listening to me read some more of it to you on a Wednesday night. It's not, and these are good things, but they're not all the things that we need. It's not listening to your favorite pastor, preacher, leader, or teacher on a podcast or watching their videos on YouTube once or twice a week. You have to personally engage with the Word of God. When you read it with your own eyes, when you read it aloud and hear your own voice speaking these things back to you, it becomes personal. It becomes impactful. It becomes the transforming, powerful force that God always intended it to be in our lives. And when we allow it, that space in our lives, when we allow the Word of God in its proper place in our lives, it leads to teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training, which prepares us for those good works and allows us to be set up to make sure that we're handling that word properly. I want to take you back to 1 Timothy now, chapter 4. And we're going to look at verses 1 through 8. Because just in case you think some of what I've just talked about is my own ideas, thoughts, or imaginations, God warned us that it was coming. Chapter 4, verse 1, the Spirit clearly says that in later times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars whose consciences have been seared as with a hot iron. They forbid people to marry and order them to abstain from certain foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and who know the truth. For everything God created is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, because it is consecrated by the word of God and prayer. If you point these things out to the brothers and sisters, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus, nourished on the truths of the faith and of the good teaching that you have followed. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. And so there's a portion of this that we recognize as discernment. And simply described and put to you, that is your knowledge of the word at work in tandem with the Spirit of God at work within you, and you see something, come in contact with something, become aware of something, and there's that thing in you that you get this check in your spirit. And you maybe can't even always put your finger on exactly what or why, but you know something isn't right. And sometimes that works also in conjunction with some common sense things that we see in the natural. And then we apply the spiritual to it. I'm going to give you an example. I have found that for whatever reason, and I hate that I can say this and believe that it's true, but I have found that at least a certain subset of Christians, a certain subset of the church, are some of the most gullible people you will ever meet. Now, I'm not talking about anybody specifically, but if you're friends with me on Facebook, watch your toes for a second. Because some of the faithful followers of Jesus that I see sharing some of the most whacked out information on social media, I'm like, where are you? What? Who? We, oftentimes, wanting to believe that everybody we know has a heart like Jesus, will believe things that are just not true. And that's not necessarily the Bible, but things that we perpetuate in our society, things that we believe to be true. And here's my example for you. The other day, I think it was on Friday, I was in a pretty large bookstore here in Middle Tennessee. And I had really no reason to be there. I was there with my family, just wandering around aimlessly. And when I wander around aimlessly through a bookstore, I typically find myself in the section of the bookstore that has some kind of devotional books, Christian living, Bibles, those sorts of things. And so I'm just walking through and I'm looking to see what's on the shelf. And there was one book at first that caught my eye. It was a book that was written by a social media influencer. I'm not going to name names, partly because I don't know if I can say it right. But I've seen the videos that are produced by this individual and his media company. And while there's good things and good messages in those videos, there's nothing inherently Christ-centered about any of them. I've never seen a mention of Jesus. I've never seen even a mention of God in any kind of ambiguous form. And yet there was this book that he wrote sitting in the Christian living section of this bookstore. And I gave that one the benefit of the doubt. I thought, well, okay, well, maybe I just have missed those parts of his videos and the things that he posts. And I'm just not aware that he's a believer. And so I moved down a shelf, and there was another book published by a couple who are social media influencers. If you don't know what a social media influencer is, it's somebody who spends too much time on Facebook, Instagram, or TikTok, and somehow manages to make money doing so. Social media influencers. And so this couple wrote a book, and it was all about how to effectively argue with your spouse. And that's what caught my attention. So I was like, I could use some pointers in this area. But I've seen their videos, and I've seen the things that they post, and judging by the content that they create and put out there in the wild for the world to consume, I could say, if they're believers, I'm not seeing the fruit that you would expect to see in a follower of Christ with the platform that they have. And so now I'm really curious, and so I pick up the book and I'm flipping through and I'm looking for even one instance of a scripture or something that points to the truth of the Word of God. And I didn't read the whole book, obviously, but in that quick breeze through the pages of that book, not one instance of anything rooted or connected with the Word of God, not a mention of God or Christ. And yet there was this book hanging out in the Christian living section at this bookstore. And so then my mind goes to, well, maybe somebody picked this up from somewhere else and they sat it down here on the shelf because they found something better. So I pick it up and I flip it over. And sure enough, on the price tag stuck to the back of the book, it's labeled, categorized as Christian living. Now I can tell you with that example, you're never going to learn how to better or more effectively argue with your spouse if you're not first looking at what the truth of Scripture says about your relationship with your spouse. But there they were. And then I had to wonder, how many people walk through, see those names that they recognize from social media, and go, oh, praise God, I did not know that they were a Jesus follower. I'm going to buy three of them and give them to my nanny and my mama and then all my kin. How many do that? And then how much distortion creeps into the lives of people who read those books because it's labeled as one thing that it's clearly not. When we read scriptures here, like 1 Timothy chapter 4, and they talk about people who abandon the faith, we talk about deceiving spirits and false teachers, hypocritical liars, we get this idea that they are the black hat, black cape wearing villain of, you know, silent movies, and you go when they show up on the screen. But in reality, they come in a much more innocent package. Because the intent, not even necessarily of their heart, but the enemy at work behind the scenes, the intent is to deceive and to draw away. I want to take you one more place today. Matthew chapter 7. And this is my longest passage, so hang in there with me. We're getting near the end. Matthew chapter 7, picking up at verse 15, says, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. I didn't know I was going to talk about this, but it has struck me in the moment, and so I'm going to share. I have really been prayed for over the last 8 days or so. If you've been around very long, you know that Lisa, our children's pastor, I have saddled her with the label of being my church mama. She's my church mama because my real mama lives over 600 miles away where I grew up. And for the last 8 days, I have had in the same like 5 mile radius, not only my church mama, but my real mama and my grandma as well. And I wasn't really sure how that was gonna go when they got together and started sharing stories about me. Thus far, I've survived. But Grammy, my grandma, was telling me a story about the apple trees that I remember from when I was a kid that grow outside her house. And always, at some point, there would be applesauce, homemade from the apples that grew on the trees right outside Grammy's house. She was sharing with me, though, that a few years ago, something strange started happening. The trees would blossom. They would develop the tiny little green apples that are just the start of real apples. And then all those tiny little green apples would just fall off the tree and die. That is bad fruit. Now, there's something in those trees, or something that has happened to those trees, that has caused that to happen. She doesn't know what it is. I don't know what it is. But you're not going to make applesauce out of little green, unripe apples. It's not going to be good. It's not going to satisfy. It's not going to taste good. It's not going to nourish anybody. As a matter of fact, there's a good chance it might make you sick. That's not good fruit. There's a root behind why it's not good fruit. In the spiritual sense, fruit that is not good comes from a root that is not good. So we have to be rooted in the truth of the Word of God, not our own interpretation, but what God truly says. And when we're rooted there, and we draw on that, and from that, and through that, that's when we can truly bear good fruit that is not only good for us, but good for the body of Christ, good for our fellow believers, nourishing, satisfying, and truly contributing to the kingdom of God and the growth of his kingdom. Thus, verse 20, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Verse 21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. This goes back to, we can't just read the word. We have to engage with it. We have to live it. We have to apply it. Scripture says, do not deceive yourselves by simply reading the word, but do what it says. Verse 24. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundations on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. I called this message basic training. Basic training because this is where we have to start. This is where we have to begin. This is the simplest and most foundational truth that we have to put our feet on first. Because if we don't stand on the Word of God and the fact that it is God-inspired, infallible, authoritative, and inerrant, nothing that we talk about from here on out makes a difference, because it all becomes questionable. It all becomes something we can doubt or do away with. We have to understand that this is our foundation. We stand on the Word of God. And not what we hope it means, not what we'd like to believe it means, not what we would like to make it mean so it makes us more comfortable, but what God has really said. I want to invite the worship team back up today. And as they come and we prepare to close in worship, I want to take you back to a moment during communion today. I want to take you back to when I said, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Those who have been around a long time know that I like to say this. I love word studies and understanding what the original language means. And in the context of that verse, all have sinned. The word all means all. Everybody. You've messed up, I've messed up, and everybody in between has messed up. None of us achieve the perfection, the righteousness of God on our own. But where we do come into contact with that, and we can find ourselves counted as righteous according to the word, is in Jesus Christ. Our righteousness on our own is like dirty rags. But when we put on his righteousness, we are made more and conformed more to the image of God. If you're in that place where you have put on his righteousness, it is undeniable, irrefutable, unquestionable that you must stand on and be a student of the Word of God. You cannot live this life based on your own opinions or ideas or whatever you have formulated to be the idea of righteousness. Your life, your way of living, your very being must be conformed to and defined by what God says. And we can talk about how God speaks prophetically and speaks into people's lives and all those things, and how God still speaks, and yes, he does. But please don't let that become a substitute for the Word of God. It is black and white, accessible to you, right in front of you. Engage with it and live it. And if I have just left you in the dust and you're like, I don't even know what it is to know Jesus or to put on his righteousness or whatever that is that you said, then today the invitation is to get ready to really effectively engage with the Word of God by first surrendering your life to the one who can make you whole. Look, I don't know what your personal life is like. I don't know all the details of your day-to-day. I don't know what you face when you close out that window on your TV or your computer or your phone, or what you face when you walk out these doors today. I don't know that. But I do know that for me, I wouldn't want to face any of it, no matter what it is, outside of my relationship with Christ. See, there's a lot of things in our world that want to rob us of the truth of God's word. And if we let them rob us of the truth of his word, then they can rob us of peace. They can rob us of hope. They can rob us of love. They can rob us of joy. They can rob us of all of the fruits of the Spirit. They rob us of a good root. And then rob us of the ability to produce a good fruit. Today, whether you're at home or in the room, you're in a space and a place in time where you have an opportunity to meet your Creator. And not just your Creator, but your Savior. So I want to invite each of you, no matter where you are, just into an attitude of prayer with me today. I want to acknowledge some things first and foremost, and that is that we are living in an uncertain and oftentimes frightening world. So many people are racked with concern, consumed by fear of what's going to happen tomorrow, what's going to happen next week, what's going to happen next year. I'm grateful to God that it's not my job to know the answers to those kinds of questions. It's also not your job to know the answers to those kinds of questions. There's only one who truly does know the answer to those questions, and that is God alone. And I'll be honest, I wonder about some of those things. But as a general rule, I do not worry. First and foremost, because most of them, there's nothing I can do about it. But more importantly, I know the one who's in control of it all. And so today, if you're one of those that's just lost in worry and confusion and concern, and you are trying to figure it out on your own, and you don't know the one who does know, and I want to invite you to meet him today. He is the God who has spoken everything we know into existence. He is the God who orchestrated the writing and compiling of these 66 books that we call the Bible. Those are his words, and he didn't just write them for people who were living thousands of years ago, but he wrote them for you. And in those pages is truth for living, truth for your life, truth that will bring you peace, truth that can bring you hope, truth that will set you free. And today, the first truth that you can grab a hold of, cling to, and build a new life on is that that very same God loved you so much that he laid down his own earthly life so that you might have eternal life. He died so that you can live. So as that Spirit of God moves right now in this room and in homes and offices, if that's you today, just there in your heart and in your mind, just want to invite you to pray this simple prayer. Jesus, I need you and I need your life. I have lived too long trying to figure things out on my own. And now I know I need to trust in you. Give me new life. Save me today. Start something new in me. If you did pray that prayer today, the first thing that I want to let you know is that that's not a promise for an easy life, but it is a promise that he is with you. He goes with you. That he will provide all your needs. That he can do immeasurably more than you could ever even imagine in your life and for you. And the second thing that you need to do is let someone that you know is walking with Jesus, let them know that you've taken that step today. If you don't know anyone that you can let know that, then let me know that. If you're here in the room, see me before you leave and we'll talk more, because you're not going to take this journey alone. Because I honestly, I may have deceived you just a little bit. You didn't just step into new life in Christ. You stepped into a whole new family. And you are not called to live that life alone. We're going to walk it with you. If you're at home, then you can send us a message right through Facebook. Let us know. We'll get in touch with you. Or go to our website, fill out that connect card, and let us know that you made a decision for Jesus today. You're not going to walk this alone either. That's not who we're called to be or what we're called to do. We're called to community, to live this life in Christ together. So now, God, I have said all I can say and done all I can do, and the rest I leave in your hands. But I thank you that you are the God who speaks peace over every uncertainty. You are the God who speaks truth that silences every lie. That you are the God who at the mention of your name, every enemy and every agent of darkness must flee. And so we thank you for what you've done today, for how you have moved here among us and in us, and for what you're going to continue to reveal to us through your word. And for all that and so much more, we lift you up, we exalt you, we praise you, give you all of the glory today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Surrounding me, let it break. call the sea to still, the rage in me to still every way. At your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, we call these bones to live, call these bones to sing, and once again, I will things breathe. Call these bones to live, these bones to sing, and once again, I will praise. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble.
Jesus, we thank you for what you've done here today. We thank you for transformed lives, for drawing us closer to you, for revealing the truth of who you are and what you have spoken. As we go from this place today, we ask that you would continue to stir that in our hearts, that we would be reminded that as we go, we do not go alone, but that you go before us, come along behind us, and surround us on every side, so that no matter what we face outside these walls, we can know that we are in your hands and we do not need to fear. We thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth that you have set before us. Give us a hunger now to know it and to know you better. We love you. We praise you and we thank you for all that you have done, for all that you have yet to do. We lift all this up in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Church, I love you. I hope we'll see you back here Wednesday night at 6:30 for our night of prayer for students and school faculty.